World celebration. The theme this time is digital generation.
Yeah.
Let's start from that. Why is that theme so important to the girl child?
Because we are talking of a girl child and the digital generation. We are living in a digital world.
That's right.
And so these girls are exposed to many things. Mm-hmm. And apart from that, we are looking at the current generation, which are also calling digital generation. Mm-hmm. And so merging between the two, how can they work together just to ensure that girls are helped in the right manner?
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And apart from that, we also do know that the COVID-19 pandemic has affected so much in matters of health and has also brought about the existing inequalities that we have seen. However, the fact that you mentioned on the digital generation,
yes.
Let's look at the positive side of it. What can we report as per now?
Yeah, for example, by the use of technology, you find mostly because when we are talking about girls, we're looking at empowerment.
Mm-hmm.
And how are we empowering these girls? And we have various ways of empowerment. We are looking at these girls either using the gadgets, mm-hmm. To learn positive things. Apart from that, we're looking at bringing in mentors to work with these girls grow in different areas. And just having people who are serving as good examples to help these girls grow, it plays a big role in their life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And especially in the informal settlements,
yes.
Where this internet or the digital world is not so famous to most of these girls,
mm-hmm.
These are some of the glaring inequalities that obviously need to be addressed.
Yeah.
But what role can societies play in relation to this?
Yeah, for example, focusing at our children's home, mm-hmm. You find it has been a bit hard even for children to access these gadgets, but we've reached out to individual well-wishers, talked to them, and now we have some few tablets and laptops, and kids can do their online learning. Later, they can be given homework by teachers and later research. And now that we are in informal settlements, the areas of Dagoretti,
mm-hmm.
Wanye Road, Riruta Satellite, and our neighbors, you find there we have Ngando Slum, we have Kawangware,
mm-hmm.
On the other side we have Kibra. And so these children, they want to learn, but they are less privileged because you find some of them at home, they have no electricity.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes even as we focus maybe on matter CBC, you find maybe they have been given homework, they are supposed to be assisted by the parents,
mm-hmm.
And maybe it is supposed to be Googled or get the link and download.
Mm-hmm.
But you find some of the parents, they cannot do that. So this kind of a child, when he or she comes to school,
right.
You find they are a bit disadvantaged because others have done homework,
mm-hmm.
and she has not done homework.
Mm-hmm.
So for those that are coming from informal settlements, they are disadvantaged in a way. And how I wish that the government talked about the laptop projects, they could avail to even those in slums, because you find my biggest worry is that we talked about the project,
mm-hmm.
But my biggest worry is whether the project is being implemented. Yeah, and so you find most of the children, they would like to access these gadgets, but because of one reason or the other, they have not. There are some of the schools in slums, maybe they have a small space, and also because of insecurity, they have even nowhere to
mm-hmm.
To keep the or to store the tablets and laptops.
Mm-hmm.
So this has been a challenge, and it has brought inequality between children in informal settlements and also children who are maybe brought up by the well-off parents.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a big challenge in our society because now we are not growing on the same level.
Exactly.
Because when KCP and KCSE exams,
mm-hmm.
is the same paper, when it comes is the same paper. But you know, there is this kind of inequality. This has not accessed.
Right.
This has had access to these materials.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in the near future, then, what's the solution here? Because we are celebrating the Day, yeah. of the Girl Child, but
yes.
here we are, a part of the community or society,
yeah.
does not even know what we are actually celebrating about.
Yeah.
There are those that who do not even understand much about the digital platform.
Mm.
Where are they left?
So it's a big challenge, because as the community grows, we like now we tend to leave them behind, and you find they are behind in many, many ways. What we need to do, we need to do a lot of advocacy, join hands, the government, the NGOs, the private sector, the guys in children homes, and all people who are helping children or girl child in the society. We just team up together and continue with the advocacy, we continue with the awareness. Because again, these digital platforms, they are very helpful to create awareness to these children. We have, we've had some cases whereby there are forums maybe out there, like people are going out speaking about the challenges girls are facing in the community, creating awareness. For example, when somebody touches you and you know, you're supposed to report this, how you need to respond about it,
right,
and you don't keep quiet about it, because the next they will go to the next level and make advances. Such kind of things, you know, those kind of platforms, they create opportunity for awareness, and in that case our girls will have more knowledge even to take good care of themselves.
Yeah. And Bernard, do you think that we should relook into, you know, these reforms? Because we talked about, you know, some of the cases that go unheard.
Yeah.
And during this time of COVID-19, we've had the rates of violence going high. And this, of course, has posed a great threat to women and children. So what strategies can we look at a local level, you know, whereby you talked about if a child has, you know, you talked about someone taking advantage of her, but the moment you report, that particular case takes longer, or will even go and will even go without being looked into that. So what strategies are you looking at?
First is about the community. Number one has to start with we have to change the mindset of our community also, because for quite some time, because of cultural traditions, we've had our girls suppressed in many, many things. Look at the decision making at home. Sometimes you find maybe a parent has a property you want to divide among your children. You find maybe girls, the boys have been given a 1 acre, and the girls have been given a quarter an acre,
or even none. That's true.
Yeah. So first we have to change the mindset of our community, and be able to just enlighten them and know that the girl child has an equal right, the same as the boy child. And apart from that, we also need to do a lot of advocacy, just to ensure that we are championing their rights and give them that opportunity to be empowered and lead. Because when we empower them at this period, I don't know even as a country we can be able to go wrong in future. So this will be the best time for us to join hands, work together, and just enlighten them and empower our girls. And I know they will do the best.
But we still have a long way to go.
We still have a long way to go, because even you find the people who are supposed to support the girls, again, are the ones either misusing them in ways. So you find a lot of advocacy is needed, and the community has to change the mindset.
Let's now talk about children from vulnerable backgrounds and also the orphaned in the society. Currently, it is estimated that we have about 3 million orphaned children in the country. 47% of the orphaned have been orphaned as a result of HIV and AIDS, and many more still remain vulnerable, you know, due to other several factors. Let's start from that. How is the future looking for them?
For the kids, I think there has recently also been, if you compare with our past, I think as a country we are also making strides. However, we've not done a lot of focus to that effect, and so what is happening mostly, there are these children that are maybe on streets, and some of them maybe they lost their parents, and apart from that we have, like, some of them contract AIDS either through through rape. And again, it just comes back to the community, like, are we respecting the rights of the children? And so a lot of advocacy is needed for people to just ensure that they are there, they're respecting the rights of the children, and people who are involved in handling children, we work together as a team. In case there is any case that has been reported somewhere, mm-hmm. we rescue those children, take them to a safe place, even if it is in a children's home, and we continue helping in that manner. That's what we do at Cheryl's. Mm-hmm. At Cheryl's Children's Home, we have children from who have passed through various kinds of assault. Mm-hmm. Maybe some are survivors of sodomy, for the boys, some are survivors of rape,
right.
survivors of abandonment. You look at this, all these kind of vices people have done to children, mm-hmm. Which are very, very dehumanizing.
Yeah.
And what we need to do as a community, and we also, the government need to back us up in this, because sometimes you find the cases are taking too long.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the case is reported, but it takes too long, and you know, people continue doing that. If we bring can I say harsh rules?
Yes.
Yeah, we bring harsh rules, and if there is any offender, they mm-hmm. pass through the harsh rules, and then they are able to, I think, rectify such kind of mistakes,
mm-hmm.
and then as a community, we continue to respect the dignity of children.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And Bernard, when you talked about the vulnerable in the society,
yeah.
The street kids
yes.
are part of those.
Yes.
And we have seen them all over,
yeah.
not just here in the Nairobi town, but all over the country.
Yeah.
One point, we have seen them being put together
yeah.
for them to be provided for, you mm. know, with the basic needs.
Mm.
But after some time, we have cases of some of them, you know, escaping from
yeah,
those
yeah.
particular institutions. So what can be done, because it's already it looks like they already have the mentality
mm.
that they should be on the streets
mm.
and not somewhere being provided for shelter just like
mm.
the rest. This is inequality as well.
Yeah. For example, we've had just to bring you closer,
mm-hmm.
we've had a case of we rescued a child at Cheryl's Children's Home
mm-hmm.
from street. One day we were visited by our donors and they were walking around.
Yeah.
They were touched with one child
mm-hmm.
when we were walking around. And so we rescued that child from street. The child had medical issues. We took him to the hospital
mm-hmm.
and after he was okay, he was treated and was okay.
Yeah.
Then he started schooling. But after a period of about 2 months, yeah, the child escaped and went away.
Mm-hmm.
And what this child was taking was telling the rest of the children is that, you know, on streets I have a special menu.
Okay.
Yeah, I have.
Well,
I have
which
a day.
Is that special menu?
I have a special menu. I have a day to just to have chicken
mm-hmm.
and chips.
Yes.
And you know, you taking me here the whole day. I'm in class,
mm-hmm.
and at the end of the day, you're giving me gideri.
Yeah. And then so, plus the rules.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it was a big challenge. We tried again to follow up, but mm-hmm. We didn't find the child at all. But however, we appreciate that we were able at least to sort and solve his medical condition.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but this is the mindset that children are having. And how I wish that the government could formalize and have just good policies just to ensure that all these children on streets, maybe they have a safe home and they are taking these children there, that nobody is on a street. Because you find like in developed countries, for example, like America,
yeah.
they have those kind of safe homes, like nobody will just have nowhere to stay. At least you have somewhere to stay
mm-hmm.
and you are sure that I'm going to get a meal.
Mm-hmm.
How I wish that our government could copy such kind of thing. You find we have, at our institution, we have two social workers who are helping in like identifying these kind of cases in the community,
right.
going out, reaching out and see if we rescue those children and maybe they are taken to hospital, they are following up with hospitals to ensure that the appointments those children are being taken for their appointments.
Mm-hmm.
They do an amazing job, and I think they're also girls. That's we have Bill Hanjeri and also we have Judith.
Mm-hmm.
They have been helping a lot, and you know, in these children, just trying to bring in mentors to work with them.
Mm-hmm.
But the mindset we have in the community is the one we need to change, and then government should come up with good policies
yeah.
that will be able to help cover all the children.
Mm-hmm.
That nobody will lack food. and nobody will lack a home and just needs. Somewhere to to sleep. Yeah.
And as we wind up, let's talk about the parents' role, which is very important in the society. But recently we've had cases of early pregnancies, rape, etc. And all these have been linked. Some of these cases have been linked to, you know, parents not being there for their children. But again, we cannot all blame it or blame it all on the parents. So let's look at the bigger picture where do we currently have, for example, an out-of-school program where it is, which is appropriate and safe for these children, where probably after school they are taken there just to be taught on the ways of life?
At the moment, we, and I know the whole country should be working on this. First, I'm glad for the Ministry of Education because they provided by 3:10, then kids will have the after-school program and do a lot of mentorship programs. For our case, what we do, apart from the school that we have that provides education for all these children, we have worked with mentors. We have staff, we have a head teacher who connects, she's called Rose. She's able to connect with other partners and assisted by one of our also staff member called Fanuel, they're able to connect with other people from the community that are doing different roles that will help in child development. So we bring in mentors. For example, we have a partnership with Daystar University, Strathmore, and USIU. They bring their children, their students who have passed through their institution for child therapy. When they come, we assign them individual children. They are able to work with them and help. There are children who are saying, you know, I want to be a journalist like you. We have to bring a journalist like you just to work with them and say, you know, you can break these banks. You can be able to work from this children home and just go all the way to where you want. The two questions are, what do you want to be and who do you want to be?
Exactly. Yes. You know, they say seeing is believing.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Bernard Wandera. He's from Cheryl Children's Home and Learning Center. Thank you so much for your insights. And that takes us to the end of the Daily Brief at this hour. Join me at exactly 1 p.m. for K24 Newscast. Stay with us.